to Mark chapter 12 this morning. Mark chapter 12. The title of the message is A Scandal in the Vineyard. Jesus gives a parable here. Again, this is during the last week of his earthly ministry. And he's in the temple here. He's traveling. He's throughout Jerusalem. But here we believe he's actually in the temple. And he starts to give some parables. And one of the parables from verses 1 through 12, we'll read all these verses. And then we'll back up as a parable of a Lord in his vineyard. So Mark 12 and verse 1, it says, "And he began to speak unto them by parables." And again, remember, every time there's a parable, there always are scoffers present. There may be some pregnant scoffers there, but there are always present someone who is an unbeliever who is a scoffer, and Jesus is trying to hide truth from them, but also to reveal truth to those that are open. So he began to speak unto them by parables. "A certain man planted a vineyard and set an hedge about it and digged a place for the wine fat and built a tower and let it out to husbandmen, and went into a far country. And at the season, he sent to the husbandmen a servant, that he might receive from the husbandmen of the fruit of the vineyard. And they caught him, and beat him, and sent him away empty. And again he sent unto them another servant, and at him they cast stones, and wounded him in the head, and sent him away shamefully handled. And again he sent another, and him they killed, and many others, beating some and killing some. Having yet therefore one son, his well-beloved, he sent him also last unto them, saying, They will reverence my son. But those husbandmen said among themselves, This is the heir. Come, let us kill him, and the inheritance shall be ours. And they took him and killed him, and cast him out of the vineyard. What shall therefore the Lord of the vineyard do? He will come and destroy the husbandmen, and will give the vineyard unto others. And have you not read this scripture? The stone which the builders rejected is become the head of the corner. This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. And they sought to lay hold on him, but feared the people, for they knew that he had spoken the parable against them. And they left him and went their way." In this passage, I want to look at five things this morning as we walk through. We've got to make sure that we do this in the Bible whenever we come to it, keep it in the right context. That first of all, we've got the story, and then we've got the interpretation, the direct interpretation of the story, and then we can get to application. We can't just jump in the Bible and go straight to the application. So the story that Jesus gives, the parable, he paints a picture of a vineyard. You've got a man that's a rich man. We don't know how rich he is, but he is the owner. He is the Lord of this vineyard. He owns everything. It says that he, there in verse 1, a certain man planted a vineyard, set an hedge about it, digged a place for the wine fat, built a tower, and then he let it out to husbandmen. That is, he hires people, he hires gardeners to take care of this vineyard that he has bought, that he has built, that he's provided everything for. The Lord of this vineyard is the owner. And then he hires some that are gardeners, or if we can use the word stewards, he hires some to take care of what he has provided. And then he's going to come later and reap what he has sown. And they've taken care of it. They've made sure that it's watered and so forth. And then he's going to come and collect the fruit. He's going to come and harvest that fruit. And what he does is that he sends other servants. You could maybe call these husbandmen his servants in a way. And then he sends to them other of his servants. He doesn't come himself at first. He sends servants to come and collect. This is, you know, just the way that they operate in their society. At the certain season, when it was time to expect fruit, when it was time to expect a harvest, he sends his servants. And the first thought I want to look at this morning of these husbandmen, these gardeners that the Lord places there, the first thing I want to look at is their discontentment. These men had a progressively growing discontentment with the plan that the Lord had set up. He said, here's the plan. I'm the owner. I'm hiring you. And by the way, I'm sure that the Lord was fair. I'm sure that he didn't rip them off. He paid them a wage that was worthy of what they did. But as they are sitting there and the wheels start turning day by day, they're thinking, we've done a lot of work here. I mean, yes, he bought it all and he gave us all the provisions for all of it, but we've done a lot of work here. And you know, I think I deserve a little bit more than this wage that he has promised me. And instead of, they don't go and ask for anything of the Lord. They don't properly bring any negotiations, not that it's necessarily proper to always try to negotiate higher wages, but they decide they're going to do something different. They're just going to take matter into their own hands, and it all starts with this discontentment with the plan. It was a fine plan that the Lord of the vineyard had, but they had a better idea. They had greener pastures in mind. They wanted more. And it all started here with this discontentment. And so, by the way, the picture here that Jesus draws is that God the Father has entrusted to the nation of Israel a vineyard. And we won't turn there, but we could look at Isaiah 5, and it gives this picture again, that God has planted a vineyard, and he's done everything to provide for it, and he looks for a harvest. He looks for fruit at the right time. And God has given this to Israel, but they had a better idea than God. Specifically then, what the vineyard that God gives to Israel is, if we could call it the worship system that God set up, if you want to call it Judaism, God gives to Israel the plan of salvation. He gives them, apart from what the rest of the world is doing, he gives them the path to how to know God, the path to how to please God, the path to when they stand before God someday, they can hear, well done, thou good and faithful servant. They can have eternal life. God gives them all of this. And by the way, God is very specific in the Old Testament, in the law. There were a lot of I's to dot and a lot of T's to cross. God was very specific with them about how he was to be worshiped. God never just said, I want you to know me and worship me. Now just go and figure out how to do that. He didn't do that. He gave them very detailed plans. By the way, so detailed that a lot of people look at that and say, I can never do all this. And that was part of the plan, is for God to show them they could never work their way to heaven. They could never be righteous and perfect on their own. But God gave them very detailed instructions. And Israel said, you know what? We have a better idea. They started to look for greener pastures out in the world. They had a worship system ordained by God, but they started to envy what the world had. Look at the way they worship. We like the way they worship. We like their gods. We like their lifestyle. Look how, by the way, they incorporated this and that throughout, but some of the things that they desired, that they liked, was that some of the pagan religions, they had a temple where they worshiped their gods and goddesses, and they had temple prostitutes. And you could go there and you could really live it up. And they began to desire other things than the holiness that God had done for them, that God had set up for them. They were discontent with the plan and the program of God. And by the way, when God calls us to be stewards in his economy, what's a steward? A steward is someone who manages and takes care of something that does not belong to him at all. He takes care of something that belongs to somebody else. So what somebody else says, the owner, he is in charge of the way that things are to be done. For sake of time, we won't turn here. But listen to 1 Corinthians 4 and verses 1 and 2. It says, let a man so account of us as of the ministers of Christ. And the word minister is servants. A lot of times we think, oh, he's a minister. He's a high exalted minister. The word minister just means a servant. It automatically means you're under someone, and we're under Jesus. It says, let a man so account of us as of the ministers of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. That's all we are. We're just stewards. We take care of it. And then verse 2 says this, moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. And we've mentioned this first couple weeks ago on a Sunday night, I think. That's all God is looking for in us. He's not looking for us to reinvent the wheel. He's not looking for us to be so wise that we've got great ideas. He just wants us to be faithful, to take care of what he owns the way that he wants it to be taken care of. And we will always get in trouble whenever we are discontent with his plan and step outside of it and look for something else. And by the way, whenever we embrace something else, we always embrace weakness. That's not our intent. By the way, look at 2 Chronicles chapter 25 If you would turn there, I want to read several verses. 2 Chronicles 25. Nobody ever says, you know what? Just to have all this wonderful stuff, it's so awesome, but you know, I'd rather just have something weak. I'd rather fail. They don't say that, but the devil deceives them into thinking that what they're going to do is better. But whenever we are discontent with what God has given us, whenever we step out of that, we always embrace weakness in the judgment of God. So look what Israel did in 2 Chronicles 25 and verse 5. This is about a king named Amaziah. This is during the days of the divided kingdom, where you have Judah in the south and Israel in the north. And this wasn't 100% of the time true, but largely Judah was closer to God and had more of God's blessings, and Israel had more wicked kings that were following after idolatry and so forth, intermarriage with the heathen. So that's what's going on here. Israel does not have God's blessing. Judah has more of God's blessing. And Amaziah, by the way, Amaziah was a little bit of a back and forth king. It says that he did right in the sight of the Lord, but not with a perfect heart. So this is a good example of this passage. 2 Chronicles 25, and let's start reading in verse 5. It says, "Moreover, Amaziah gathered Judah together." So he's the king of Judah, and he gathers them together to fight. And look what happens in verse 6. "He hired also 100,000 mighty men of valor out of Israel for 100 talents of silver." So he's in Judah, and he's hiring people that are not walking with God from Israel in the north. Look at verse 7. "But there came a man of God to him, saying, 'O king, let not the army of Israel go with thee, for the Lord is not with Israel, to wit, with all the children of Ephraim. But if thou wilt go, do it. Be strong for the battle. God shall make thee fall before the enemy. For God hath power to help and to cast down.' And Amaziah," I love this verse, "and Amaziah said to the man of God, 'But what shall we do for the 100 talents which I have given to the army of Israel? I already hired them. I already spent the money. I'm committed. I can't go back now.' And the man of God says, 'You can go back.'" Look what it says. "The man of God answered, 'The Lord is able to give thee much more than this.'" Let that money go. God can give it back if he wants. He can give you much more. By the way, here's a great principle. This is not really what our message is about, but it is never too late. You are never too committed to the things of the world, to evil, to bail on that and walk with God. It is never too late to do what's right. Look at verse 10. "Then Amaziah separated them." He obeys. "He separated them, to wit, the army that was come to him out of Ephraim, to go home again. Wherefore their anger was greatly kindled against Judah, and they returned home in great anger. And Amaziah strengthened himself and led forth his people and went to the Valley of Salt and smote of the children of Seir 10,000. So he wins the victory. He obeys God, and God blesses him, and he wins. Verse 12. "And other 10,000 left alive did the children of Judah carry away captive and brought them unto the top of the rock and cast them down from the top of the rock that were all broken in pieces." And so he defeats 20,000 people of the Edomites. Look at verse 14. "Now it came to pass, after that Amaziah was come from the slaughter of the Edomites, which he won, the God of Judah beat the gods of the Edomites," if we can call it that. He won. Verse 14. "Now when it came to pass, after that Amaziah was come from the slaughter of the Edomites, that he brought the gods of the children of Seir, who he had just beaten, and set them up to be his gods, and bowed down himself before them, and burned incense unto them. Wherefore, the anger of the Lord was kindled against Amaziah, and he sent unto him a prophet, which said unto him," and this is the truth I want to point to, "'Why hast thou sought after the gods of the people, which could not deliver their own people out of thine hand?'" Whenever Israel would leave God and embrace any other gods, they automatically embrace weaker gods. There's nobody stronger than God. Whenever, and they were discontent, "Oh, we have God, and you know, he gives us power, and we win all the battles, but shh, what else you got?" You know, that's the idea. And they become discontent with serving God, and they would rather serve these other gods that are not even strong enough to help them win battles. And whenever we embrace anything but God's plan, we automatically embrace weakness. We embrace something inferior. We embrace opening ourselves up to the judgment of God. And we need to know that what God has given us, and by the way, for sake of time, there's a lot of areas we could go this morning that we're really not going to go, but what God has given us in marriage, what God has given us in our home, what God has given you in your job, what God has given you with your possessions. God wants us to be content with that, with his plan. You find your plan, you find God's plan for your life, and you get on that path and you stay there, and we don't look around to the left and to the right with discontentment, looking for something better. Some people are always looking for a better stone to jump to, always. They are never content in life. And whenever we're discontent with what God wants us to have, we will always embrace weakness. We'll always go downhill from that. And this would be like fighting a battle. Imagine two armies. It's like fighting a battle with one side has automatic weapons, automatic machine guns, and they are fighting against an army that uses rubber band shooters. And they win. Man, they destroyed those rubber band shooters. And then they get over there and they're like, man, these rubber band shooters are awesome. Let's switch over to this. Let's have this be our arsenal going forward. It's stupid. And that's what we do whenever we embrace anything other than God's plan. This is a losing plan. If you go with anything other than God's plan, it leads to hell. It leads to destruction. It leads to regret and so forth. Doesn't make any sense. That's what this prophet's trying to point out to Amaziah. That's what Jesus is trying to point out to Israel. They've left God for something else, anything else, and you're automatically going to be destroyed. It says, and won't turn here, but Judges 10, 13 and 14. Yet ye have forsaken me and served other gods, wherefore I will deliver you no more. Go and cry unto the gods which ye have chosen. Let them deliver you in the time of your tribulation. And then Israel turns, this is in the book of Judges, when Israel says, okay, I get it. They can't deliver me. But God says, now you want to come to me for help. How about those gods you're serving? Why don't you cry to them? They're just rocks and stones. They're just wood. They can't help you at all. We need to have contentment with what God has given us because it's beautiful. The devil tries to paint it in a different way. But what God has given us is wonderful and beautiful. Let's look at the classic passage, 1 Timothy 6, the classic passage on contentment in the Bible. Here it's talking about money, but it can really spread out into a lot of different areas of life to be content with what God has allowed us to have. So 1 Timothy 6 and verse 6, we'll start there. And then after this, we'll look at a passage in Proverbs 5. 1 Timothy 6, 6 says, but godliness with contentment is great gain. The richest person in the world is a person who is godly and he's content with what he has. For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. And having food and raiment, let us be therewith content. But they that will be rich, and the word will means he has a desire, he has a longing to be rich. But they that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare and into many foolish and hurtful lusts which drown men in destruction and perdition. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. Contentment with what God has given is beautiful. The opposite, covetousness, will always lead us into sin. And it says here, it's a great verse that's often misrepresented or misunderstood. The love of money, we often say that it's not money that's the root of all evil, it's the love of money. And also, what does it mean that the love of money is the root of all evil? It doesn't mean that whenever somebody did something wrong, it's because they loved money, because they were covetous. It means that loving money is the fountain and the spring that can result in all kinds of evil. If you want to name any kind of evil, somebody's willing to go there for the love of money. If somebody is covetous, there is no line that eventually they're not willing to cross. Sometimes you say, well, I would do that and that, but I would never do that. If somebody loves money enough, they'll eventually be willing to do anything. People will kill for money. People will commit adultery for money. People will deceive. People will do anything if they are not content with what God has given. It's something that grows inside of us like a cancer, and it will ruin any of us if we're not content with what God has given. Look at Proverbs chapter 5. One of the areas that if you're married, God has given you. By the way, if you're single, God is for the time being given you singlehood, and we're to be content with that. Some people are not content. They step out of God's plan. They commit sin, and the Bible has a lot to say about that as well. But if you're married, God has given us our spouse, and we're to be content with that husband or that wife. And to desire something else, to step out of that, always leads to destruction. There's a lot in the Bible about destruction outside of God's plan in marriage. But look at Proverbs 5. I love how it just speaks to the not just contentment. We often use the word contentment as a boring word. Like, I could have that, but I'm content. You know, kind of like an Eeyore. No, contentment here is I am satisfied. I'm totally fulfilled. I don't need anything else. That's the picture here of contentment. So look at Proverbs 5, verse 15. It says, drink waters out of thine own cistern. And running waters, this is talking about your marriage, and running waters out of thine own well. Let thy fountains be dispersed abroad and rivers of waters in the streets. Let them be only thine own and not strangers with thee. Let thy fountain be blessed and rejoice with the wife of thy youth. Let her be as the loving hind and pleasant roe. Let her breast satisfy thee at all times, and be thou ravished always with her love. And why wilt thou, my son, be ravished with a strange woman and embrace the bosom of a stranger? You know who the strange woman is here? Who the stranger is? Any woman that's not your wife. Or if you're a woman, any man that's not your husband. It's anyone else. It says, why would you be ravished? It's interesting. I was looking at that, the Hebrew word ravished, for ravished there. And it uses it in both a positive way and a negative way. It uses it with what you have with your wife, and then it uses it with what you could have with someone else. And the word is an interesting word that is a largely negative connotation. It means to, it can be translated to go astray. It's not saying that you go astray with your wife, but if you do that with a strange woman, you are going astray. But it has the idea of to be enraptured, to be enthralled, or it also has the idea of to stagger with drunkenness. Like you're intoxicated with something, and so that you're so enraptured with it. It says, be intoxicated with your wife and with your spouse's love. And why would you go out and be intoxicated and enthralled with anyone else? Find, and by the way, all of this is a command. We use these words often to talk about something that you can't help, right? Oh, I fell in love. We had to quit on our marriage because we just didn't love each other anymore. You know what the Bible says about this concept of being ravished? It says it's a command. It says, be ravished with her love. Say, well, I'm just not enraptured with her love. Then the Bible says, if you're not enraptured with her love, then be enraptured with her love. It's a choice to make. We act like it's a feeling that you can't help. It just, this happens, that happens, and I'm just swept up. It's a choice. We choose to love. And if someone's fallen out of love with their spouse, God says, I want you to choose to fall in love again. It's a choice that we make. And by the way, if loving actions are done, then loving feelings will follow. It's when we wait for the feelings that we get in trouble. So it's a command to be content, to be ravished, to enjoy the love that God has given you in marriage, and not to look over the fence at something else or someone else and to be enticed and to be drawn away internally. God wants us to be content. And these men, God had given these husbandmen, these gardeners, he had given them a plan. And it was a good plan, but they wanted something else. And that discontentment led them, number two, we'll look back in Mark chapter 12, it led them, number two, to the rejection. They started with a discontentment. They started going the wrong way. And so this Lord reaches out to them. The first time that they come, that the servant comes to collect, they beat him. They send him away empty-handed. And he begins to send more and more servants. Look at Mark 12 and verse 4. It says, and again he sent unto them another servant, and at him they cast stones and wounded him in the head and sent him away shamefully handled. And again he sent another, and him they killed, and many others, beating some and killing some. So, by the way, in this parable, the servants of the Lord that he sends, they represent the prophets that God sent to Israel. God gave Israel a plan. They were discontent and they stepped out of it. So God sends them in love. They thought it was God hating them. Oh, you're ruining our lives. Get these prophets out of here. But in love, God sent them prophets to call them back and they rejected those prophets. Let's look at some verses, three passages. Look at Matthew 5, then we'll look at Matthew 23, where this was Israel's status quo throughout the Old Testament. They sinned against God, God sent them a prophet, and they rejected the prophet. Very rarely did a prophet's message fall on receptive ears. There were some examples, but for the most part, the prophets were rejected. And we see this borne out in these verses. Look at Matthew 5 and verse 12. It says, if you're persecuted for the cause of Christ, rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. As a whole, the prophets were rejected and persecuted. Look at Matthew 23 and verse 34. Matthew 23 and verse 34. This is Jesus speaking again. It says, wherefore, behold, I send unto you prophets and wise men and scribes, and some of them ye shall kill and crucify, and some of them ye shall scourge in your synagogues and persecute them from city to city. The Apostle Paul is a good example of this. You didn't just persecute him. You didn't just persecute him and send him out. You followed him from city to city. Everywhere he'd go, Iconium, Lystra, and Derbe, these Jews would follow after Paul with their hatred. It says that upon you, next verse, that upon you may come all the righteous blood shed upon the earth, from the blood of righteous Abel unto the blood of Zacharias, son of Berechias, whom ye slew between the temple and the altar. Verily I say unto you, all these things shall come upon this generation. O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, thou that killest the prophets and stonest them which are sent unto thee. And God explains why he sent the prophets. How often would I have gathered thy children together, even as a hen gathereth her chickens under her wings, and ye would not. There was a total rejection of God's effort to draw them back. This Lord, he sends his servant. He sends the first servant to collect, and they harm him. So time and time again, he sends more and more. He gives them more and more opportunities to do the right thing every time they reject it, until something else happens. And by the way, look at Acts 7. There's an interesting word here. Acts 7 and verse 51, this is Stephen's sermon just before he is killed. I've never preached a sermon and then been killed right after it, but that was Stephen's testimony. Acts 7 and verse 51, it says this. Ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, ye do always resist the Holy Ghost. As your fathers did, so do ye. Look what it says here. Which of the prophets have not your fathers persecuted? Name me one, he says. Tell me one prophet that you didn't in some way at some time reject and persecute. What a statement. Which of the prophets have not your fathers persecuted? And they have slain them which showed before of the coming of the just one, of whom ye have been now the betrayers and murderers. And so this story that Jesus, this parable that Jesus gives, pictures what Israel did to God's plan and to God's prophets and then to the Messiah that God sends. The third thought I want to look at is mercy. First of all, there's a discontent in the men, and then there's a rejection. But then from the Lord, you see mercy. Look back in Mark 12 and verse 6. We'll read verses 6 through 8 here. Mark 12, verse 6. It says, having yet therefore one son, his well-beloved, he sent him also last. By the way, the word last is an interesting word. It's almost saying, I'm going to send him, and if you don't treat him right, that's all you get. I'm sending him last, saying, they will reverence my son. But those husbandmen said among themselves, this is the heir. Come, let us kill him, and the inheritance shall be ours. And they took him and killed him and cast him out of the vineyard. Why did the Lord send his son last? It says, he says, they will reverence my son. He sent him saying, maybe they didn't listen to the servants, the lower level, the prophets, but they'll listen to my son. Maybe God the Father saying, and by the way, it's not that God didn't know they would reject Jesus. It was all prophesied. But God is giving them a greater chance. You rejected all the prophets. Let me send you my son, the Messiah himself. and they'll listen to him. They'll finally say, what are we doing? And they'll do the right thing. And it says now they have, now their plan, their discontent plan shifts even further. At first they're thinking, we want more, we deserve more. And when they see the son, they think, we could have everything. This is the heir. If we kill him, then we could have all of it, which by the way is faulty reasoning, which we'll come back to. But the reason the Lord sent his son was that it's a greater opportunity, it's a greater chance, and they reject that also. But I had this thought. You could have skipped over verses 6 through 8, and from, look at the passage again, you could have gone from verse 5 straight down to verse 9. It says, and again he sent other, and him they killed, and many others, beating some and killing some. We could have gone right to verse 9. What shall therefore the Lord of the vineyard do? He will come and destroy the husbandman and give the vineyard unto others. The Lord would have been justified by not sending his son. He had reason and grounds enough. Let's pick a round number. Let's say he sent 10 servants and they mistreated everyone or killed some of them. He could have said, that's it. We're done. I'm destroying you. He could have done that. But instead, he gave them mercy by sending his son. He gave them one more chance when they didn't deserve another chance. And they squandered that one too. But by sending his son, it's one more opportunity. He gives them mercy. Which, by the way, with the picture of Israel, God and Israel, God sent the Messiah. He sent Jesus. He didn't owe them the Messiah to come himself. He could have said, I gave you the prophets. I gave you the law. I gave you Moses. I gave you all that you need. And you reject that, we're done. But he sends his own son. He sends Jesus as an act of mercy to show them their way one more time. He gave them one more chance, and they rejected that. By the way, when we in our lives were lost, and also when we're Christians as well, but when we were in sin and we were lost and God gave us opportunities, I don't know how many times you heard the gospel before you received it, but you heard it more than you deserved to. And I heard it more than I deserved to. And God could have stopped short with that one last time, that one last opportunity he gave us. He could have said, you've already crossed the line, that's it. We don't deserve anything. But that last opportunity he gave us and we received the gospel, that was an act of mercy. And we need to reach out to the opportunities God gives us and embrace them. We need to share that with the world as well. By the way, we need to share this truth with the world. This is the gospel, and I hope you receive it because this might be your last chance. Nobody knows about tomorrow. This could be our last opportunity. Or else God could, as it says in Romans chapter 1, God could just lift the Holy Spirit's working in their lives and say, I'm going to give you over to a reprobate mind. I'm not going to kill you right now, but you're done with opportunities to receive. God could do that, and it's a scary thought, and we need to be aware of that and be aware that every opportunity to do right is God's mercy. It's a new opportunity. This is true for us as Christians as well. God says, I want you to do my will. And we say, no, no, later. I'm going to do something else. Every opportunity is an act of mercy. And there could be a line that we cross where God says, I'm not giving you another opportunity. I was thinking about, we're not going to turn here for sake of time, but I was thinking about a lot of people in the Bible that had severe consequences, that died for things that you and I have done, and we haven't died for them. You think about Ananias and Sapphira. They lied. They did a good thing. They started with a good motivation. People have needs in the church. We want to help them. We're going to sell our house and our land, and we're going to give the money to the church. Only we're not going to give all of it. We're going to give some of it. So far, we're fine. But then they lie about how much they sold it for, and they die on the spot. It's like, whoa. It says that when the church heard that, I think some people said, okay, I'm not selling my property. I don't want to die. It wasn't that they sold the property. It's that they lied. Sometimes we take a step back and say, hey, I mean, all they did was lie. Anyone here ever lied and hasn't died right on the spot? We've all been there, right? God's mercy spared us, but we could have died. We've done things that we could have died as a result of. King Herod in the Bible, in Acts chapter 12, it says he gave a speech that was so awesome. He really hit it out of the park. His speech writers did a great job on this one. His teleprompters were working. It was a great speech. And when it was done, everyone says, that was so awesome. That was the voice of a God and not a man. And because he did not say, no, that was God's ability. That was not me. Because he didn't do that, he died on the spot and was eaten of worms. Because he gave not God the glory. Anyone else other than me Have you ever not given God the glory for something and lived to tell about it? He died right on the spot. Nadab and Abihu in the Bible were priests, and they come and they offer strange fire. They just brought, to light the incense in the holy place, they brought fire from out, they were supposed to get it from the altar in the courtyard, and which was ever burning, and take that and offer. But they just brought in a flame, a fire from somewhere else. What's the big deal of that? God said not to do it, and they did it, and they died on the spot. And so many other examples, you know, Israel in the wilderness, because of complaining about God's provision, because of complaining about God's leadership. Some of them were died by being bitten by serpents. Some of them, the earth opened up and swallowed them. And they didn't even kill anybody. They just said, oh, we don't really want to follow you. And they died on the spot. And it doesn't mean that what they did was worse than what we did, what we have done, and what we continue to do. It means God's a God of mercy. And we all could be dead 10 times over. But God gives us another chance for salvation. And for all of us that are saved, God gives us another chance to do his will. If you're living your life denying a certain truth, denying God's will in a certain area, you're here today because God's giving you another opportunity to turn and do right. But it could be the last opportunity. We need to do right now because we don't know what God gives. But God gave mercy in giving Israel another chance. The last chance was Jesus, when he sent Jesus to them and they rejected it. Let's move to number four, to the consequences of their actions. So they had a rejection, and because of that, there were consequences. We see this in Mark 12 and verse 9. It says, "What shall therefore the Lord of the vineyard do? He will come and destroy the husbandman and will give the vineyard unto others." They lost their opportunity to be stewards. And in fact, they actually lost their opportunity to stay alive because of what they did. Here was their thought. It was faulty reasoning from the beginning, by the way. We kill the servants, we kill the servants. If we kill the son, he's the heir, and we can be the heirs. In other words, they're saying, if we kill the son, then the father will say, well, I guess I can't give it to the son anymore. I guess I'll give it to you murderers. Would that ever happen in a million lifetimes? It was faulty reasoning. But that's what they had decided. They thought, we can do this and totally get away with it. There won't be consequences. We won't be held accountable, and instead we'll actually get the whole inheritance. It never would have happened. And Israel thought that they could reject God's plan and reject the Messiah and have everything turn out just right. They never considered there would be consequences for their actions. And it says, what are the consequences? He will destroy those servants and give the vineyard unto others. What's the interpretation of that? It's that when Jesus came and gave the opportunity for Israel to carry the light, to carry God's truth and be his representatives of the world, and they lost that opportunity, he destroyed them. And again, this is AD 70 at the destruction of Jerusalem is the ultimate picture of this. God destroyed Israel, he destroyed the temple, and he gave the vineyard to others. Who are the others? It's the church, it's the Gentiles that now what we have going on today. It's not that God is done with Israel, he's got a plan, but for right now, God's plan in the world is through the church. Now, if any Jewish person gets saved, they come into the church, you know, they're part of that as well. It's Jew and Gentile in the body of Christ. But God's plan in the world is not with Israel today. That doesn't mean we destroy Israel, doesn't mean we try to, you know, it's still God's truth of whoever blesses Israel, I'll bless. Whoever curses them, I'll curse. That's still active. But God's program in the world has moved on from Israel for right now. He's given that to the Gentiles. He's given that to the church. And look at a couple verses in Romans chapter 11. We'll look at a verse in Romans 11, then a verse in Acts 13 to illustrate this truth that God moved on in his plan. Because Israel rejected him, he rejected them. It doesn't mean that the church was ever a plan B. It just, in God's economy, he shows that this is what he did because they rejected him. So Romans 11, verse 11. It says, I say then, have they, Israel, stumbled that they should fall? Is God totally done with them? God forbid. But rather, through their fall, salvation has come unto the Gentiles for to provoke them to jealousy. That's an interesting concept. God says, one of the things I'm going to do by moving on to the church, by moving on to Gentiles, is for Israel to look back and say, hey, they got to be used by God. That's not fair. I want to be used by God. And God wants to have the church provoke them to jealousy, to desire to believe in God again. But for right now, God has moved on to the Gentiles. Look at Acts 13 in verse 46. Paul and Barnabas are speaking here. Acts 13, 46. It says, then Paul and Barnabas waxed bold and said, it was necessary that the word of God should first have been spoken to you, Jews, but seeing ye put it from you and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, lo, we turn to the Gentiles. For so hath the Lord commanded us, saying, I have set thee to be a light of the Gentiles, that thou shouldest be for salvation unto the ends of the earth. And when the Gentiles heard this, they were glad and glorified the word of the Lord. And as many as were ordained to eternal life believed. So this happened broadly. It also happened from city to city. They would be preaching. And if the Jews rejected the gospel, then God would say, let's give it to the Gentiles. God said this. I always wanted all these Gentiles to believe here. But I wanted the Jews to be the ones to reach them. But they rejected it. So then I chose the Gentiles. I didn't choose the Gentiles just to be saved. I chose the Gentiles to be saved and then to carry it to others. And God, what God moves on is not just the plan of salvation. Jews can still come in. But he chooses to use the Gentiles not only to be saved, but then also to be the light bearers to further his kingdom. He initially said, I choose the Jews to do this in all the world. And they rejected it. So God says, I'm still going to save the world. I'm still going to reach out to the whole world. So now I'm going to choose the church to do that. And it was a great privilege that they lost out on, that they squandered and had taken away from them. And so that's the primary interpretation. By application to us, the same thing could happen to us. God could say, I want to use you to do something great for me. Now, just because we don't participate in God's plan, does God throw up his hands and say, oh, I wanted to do stuff in the world, now I guess nothing's going to get done. That's not, God's will is going to happen, but God says, you know what? You lost your opportunity. I'm going to use somebody else to do it. There's a great verse in 1 Chronicles. We won't turn there for the sake of time. 2 Chronicles, I think 16:9. It says, the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth, seeking to show himself strong in the behalf of them whose heart is perfect toward him. God is looking for somebody to use to do his plan. And we ought to be jumping up and down with our hands waving, saying, I want to be used. To be used, by the way, we have to be holy. We have to do it his way. But if we reject him, he will reject us for being able to be used. Once you're saved, he's not going to reject you from heaven, okay? But he will say, I'm done with you. You will have no more rewards. You will have no more opportunity to serve me. I'll use somebody else. And we won't know the value of that until we get to heaven. There will be great regret if God had to pass over us because we rejected his workings in our lives. But that line can be crossed. And then number five, we'll finish with this. Number five is the irony. The irony of the whole situation. Look at Mark 12 and verse 10. And we'll read down through verse 12. So there were consequences to their actions. And Mark 12 verse 10 says this. And have ye not read the scripture? The stone which the builders rejected is become the head of the corner. This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. And they sought to lay hold on him, but feared the people, for they knew that he had spoken the parable against them. And they left him and went their way. Here's what in the parable the men thought. They thought if we kill the heir, then we can have everything. And the ironic thing was they killed the heir, and that was their ultimate undoing. They get nothing. Now they're destroyed because they killed the heir. Israel thought, we can have God. We believe in God. We're going to have God's blessings. But forget about Jesus. They believed in a Messiah, but they rejected him when he came because he wasn't what they expected. And the irony of the situation was the one that they thought, the stone, the Bible says he was a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. They tripped over him. They thought, ah, who cares about him? And the irony was, that was the cornerstone you just tripped over. What you threw out, we're going to build a great building. We don't need this rock. Get this out of here. By the way, that was the chief foundation stone. If you don't have that stone, the whole building's going to fall. You have to have it built on Jesus if it's going to be blessed, if it's going to stand. It was a great irony in that situation that the one that they rejected was the only one you couldn't do without. You could do without a lot of the stones, but you can't build your building without Jesus. And that happens in life today. People hear the gospel and they say, I want to believe in God. I want to have good things and blessings and all this. But there's some other religion maybe. And we call him God, whatever, you know, just whatever you want to call him. There's some higher power. But Jesus, I mean, he was kind of narrow-minded and he said weird things and we don't want Jesus. But if you lose him, he that hath the Son hath life. He that hath not the Son hath not life. If you remove that one piece, by the way, he was the most important piece. And you can't have eternal life without him. And as Christians, we can't have blessings without him. And there was such a great irony in that. They thought they could have everything without that one piece, but he was the greatest piece. And likewise, whenever we step out of the will of God, we often think, I know God wants me to do this and this, but I could do something better. If I would just do this, then everything could be better in my life. And we look over the fence and the grass is greener on the other side. We think that it's better, but the ironic thing is you jumped over the fence for what you thought was better and instead you lost everything. Now you don't have God's blessing. Now you don't have God's plan. And sometimes we can make decisions that can't really be undone. Or at least we get to a place where we think it can't be undone. There's always hope with God. There's an old story that when I was growing up, we had these little books from a lady named Aunt Carolyn. She wrote some children's Bible stories and such. And there was a story that Aunt Carolyn told that was of a little bird, I don't remember, maybe a sparrow, some kind of a bird. And there was a peddler that would come by selling earthworms. Earthworms, earthworms. And the little bird says, "Oh, I love to eat earthworms. I'll have an earthworm." And they said, "Well, to get an earthworm, you just need to give me a feather. We'll trade an earthworm for a feather." She says, "Oh, I got lots of feathers." He gives them a feather, takes the earthworm, yummy. Next day, here comes the peddler again, and, "Oh, I want another earthworm." So he trades another feather for an earthworm. And this goes on until the bird has traded his last feather for another earthworm, and the winter comes, and the bird freezes to death and dies because he traded away what God gave him to keep him warm. And there's a statement that's often said that you may desire something. You can go get it. You may be able to get what you want, but it'll cost you what you have. And there's so many times in life where God has given us something beautiful and precious. An example would be something like our purity. God has given us our purity, and the world scoffs at it and scorns it. The world will make fun of you if you have purity. "You're a virgin? What a loser." And we're willing to trade away so that we can have something that, by the way, here's the truth. We have something that somebody else says is valuable. And so we're willing to trade away something truly valuable because we begin to think what somebody else says is valuable is valuable. You know, if you were to have something like, let's put two things side by side. Let's put a wedge of gold on one side and we'll put food on the other. How many would say, we're not going to have like a raise of hands, but man, I'd rather have that wedge of gold than that food. Ask yourself this, why would you want that wedge of gold? Can that wedge of gold sustain your life if you're starving? Why do we think that gold and diamonds and things like this, why are they valuable? Because somebody else somewhere says, "That's valuable." Now, I personally have never used gold in a way that has productively helped my life. I know that it has lots of uses and qualities and so forth, and I'm not trying to down that. But from a practical perspective, most of us can't use gold to help us unless you sell it for money to use, you know. But the gold in itself is only valuable because somebody else has ascribed value to that, and you say, "Therefore, I want it." But if you're starving and there's only a little bit of food left in the world, you could go and say, "I'll give you all this gold for food." And if somebody says, "No, I'm not going to starve. I'm going to keep the food." That gold does you no good. And we chase after things. The things that the world says are valuable, we begin to think they're valuable. But God says, "Here's what's really valuable." And we're willing to trade in what God says is valuable for what the world says is valuable, for what the world thinks is valuable, and then we trade it out and we realize it didn't really satisfy us. And we realize the ironic thing is, now I don't even have what I thought this would bring me, and I don't have what God initially gave me. I've lost both. And the ironic thing is that so many people sell their soul to the devil thinking they're getting something wonderful in life, and it turns out it's even worse than they had before. That often said, the grass is always greener on the other side, but when you get over there, you find out it was artificial. It was green, but it wasn't real. Or as one man said, the grass may be greener on the other side, but maybe it's because you're not watering your own grass. Maybe it's because you've let something fall by the wayside, and the only reason that looks better is because I'm not doing what I should on my own side of the fence. And we need to be content with what God has given us and cultivate it and grow it. And the more you get out of something what you put into it, if we would work on what God has given us, we'd have an even greater fulfillment and greater contentment with it. Don't let the world make you think that anything but His plan for you is the best. God knows what is best, and He gave it to us, a wonderful plan, but it's our discontentment that makes us step outside of it, and then there's a rejection, and then there's consequences, and there's regret. And the irony of the situation was, if I had just stayed, how many people would be in heaven? How many people are on earth today saying, if I had only done with what God gave me initially, I'd be so much happier. I'd be so much more fulfilled. I wouldn't have all this regret. God gives us wonderful things. He has given us, we need to value what He's given us, because He's given us a plan for our lives, and He's given us even possessions that are meant for us. It's what He wants for us, and I can accomplish His will with what He has given me. But the devil wants me to doubt Him. The devil wants me to have a discontentment. If you take this, it's so much better. And then we find out what God gave was best. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank You for this passage, this parable that related to Israel, but it also relates to us. Help us to find out what You want for us and to value that. You've given us our spouse. Help us to value him or her. Help us to place them at the very top and not to think that anyone could ever make us more fulfilled and satisfied, because You're the one who fulfills us as we walk with You. We don't trust in a spouse to fulfill us. We don't trust in a job. We don't trust in money to fulfill us. We trust in You to fulfill us as we are content with what You've given us. Help us not to reject Your plan, reject Your word. Help us to know that when we do, there will always be consequences. We will never get away with rejecting Your will for our lives. We'll never get away with rejecting Your word. Help us to squelch that lie of the devil, and to know that You will only reward righteousness. Help us to know there's a great fulfillment in doing Your will. Help us to embrace. You've given us all the command to share the gospel with those around us. Help us to know there's a great fulfillment in obeying that command. You've given us the command to be holy, to be separate from the world, to be light and salt, to be forgiving. Help us to know there's great fulfillment from You if we'll obey Your plan. This morning, with heads bowed and eyes closed, why don't we go ahead and stand to our feet? Just a moment. Music's going to softly play. Maybe God has spoken to your heart. Maybe there's been some area in your life where there's a discontentment with what God has ordained for you. Maybe it's been in your marriage. Maybe it's at your work, your job. Maybe it's your house, your car. Maybe your possessions. Maybe it's that the day-by-day plan and purpose for your life. Maybe there's been a discontent. I wish I had what he had. I wish I had what she had. God wants you to be content with what He has set up for you, and to know that joy. There'll be great rewards in heaven if you'll get on God's path for you and enjoy it. And as music plays softly together, we'll just have a time where we can do business with God. Say, God, help me to be content with what You've given me. Help me to be fulfilled in righteousness. And then we'll close together in prayer. Lord, we thank you for your word. I pray that you would help each of us, help our young people, help those of us that are married, those of us that are single, wherever we are in life. Help us to find your will, what you want. Help us not to say, I want to do what I want to do and have you bless it. Help us to ask to find your will and then to be content with wherever you've placed us, with whatever you've given us. Help us to strive to do your will and not to look around for what else glitters, for what else could be more exciting. Help us to be enthralled with the spouse you've given us. Help us to be enthralled with doing the will of God, for serving the creator of the universe. We could actually do something that pleases you. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you.